Okay, we will start now. So today's session is how to take rounds of patient in ICU. Patient who is admitted in ICU, whether conscious or on ventilator, anything. So those who are seeing, this is again a live ICU environment. Disturbances can be between, so please bear with us. Now this is a typical ICU scenario where you have monitors, infusions, ventilator and other drains at the bedside of the patient. So when a new resident come or the new joining come who is new to the ICU, how do you start? This is the biggest challenge they face. So many things you can know about the patient just by seeing the surroundings. First thing you should ask, what was the diagnosis of the patient? If at all you are taking regular rounds, what was the diagnosis of patient means identification. Diagnosis doesn't mean what the patient is actually today having, but identification, what is the age of the patient, gender, what was the previous comorbidities, means diabetic, hypertensive, or patient has any procedure, angioplasty or some surgery, whether he was smoker, alcoholic, any, all history, comorbid condition. Then what was the chief complaint for which he was admitted to ICU? ठीक है, शॉर्टनेस ऑफ ब्रेथ और अक्यूट हेमिप्लीजिया और अक्यूट एब्डोमेन, एनीथिंग, पेन इन द लोअर लिम, एनीथिंग, दिस मच बैकग्राउंड यू शुड नो. सो मीन्स सच एंड सच पेशेंट विथ प्रो प्रीवियस कोमॉर्बिडिटीज केम टू अवर आईसीयू और प्रेजेंटेड इन द ईआर विथ सच कंप्लेंट्स. नाउ द नेक्स्ट क्वेश्चन, दिस बैकग्राउंड यू आर हैविंग, द नेक्स्ट क्वेश्चन यू शुड आस्क, व्हाई दिस पेशेंट इज इन आईसीयू. For example, a patient of liver failure, hepatitis, or a patient of hepatitis, hepatitis E positive hepatitis. Every patient of hepatitis E positive, you don't keep in the ICU. Only those patients which land up in acute fulminant failure, hai na? For such patients, you put them in ICU. Patient of stroke with GCs of 15/15. Any patient you with GC of 15, you don't keep that particular patient in the ICU. But there must be something for that reason why the patient is here. So after identification of the patient and previous background, little bit background and chief complaint, you should think standing at the bedside, why this my patient is in the ICU. So without touching the patient, you can get the information. The first thing to start is with the monitor. We are not focusing on the monitor, ventilator, infusion room. Our idea is to get a feel on the, get a sequence in which you should see the things. So don't worry about what are the readings on the monitor or the infusion pump or the ventilator. This is just to explain how you should take the notes. Now on ventilator, the current heart rate is vitals. We'll look at the vitals. Heart rate is 101, regular. 100 is quite okay. It's regular. There is no arrhythmia. There can be arrhythmia, but it is sinus tachycardia. Now on the blood pressure, it is 135/75, arterial line is there. Whether this blood pressure is on certain supports or not, you need to see the infusion. Is there any infusion pumps giving noradrenaline, adrenaline, dopamine or dobutamine? I think no, he is not on any supports. He is on fentanyl, he is on etracurium, he is on insulin. So this blood pressure is without any support. So I think from vascular cardiac point of view or hemodynamics point of view, he is quite stable. This much idea you gave. So this is not the issue. Blood pressure is not an issue for this patient. Heart rate 101, 102, sinus tachycardia could be of multiple things, could be a fever, pain, anything else, but it is not so alarming. Okay. Third thing you will see, saturation of 90. If I say patient of saturation of 90, 90 saturation means in it's fine. 90 saturation, keep, ask them to keep a little bit silence. So 90 saturation per se is a good figure, okay, our patient is having 90 saturation. But for to maintain that 90 saturation, what are the settings of the ventilator or BiPAP or the oxygen which you are providing? 90 saturation on room air is a good thing, but let's see how much the ventilator is putting effort to keep the saturation 90. So what I am seeing here, I am telling you, FiO2 is 100%, First thing, that means lungs, they have some pathology in the lung, because on 100%, 90% is the saturation. Secondly, we are seeing here PEEP is 12. Definitely something bad is happening with the lung. So just by looking in the monitor and the ventilator, you get an idea that some pathology is in the lung. A PEEP of 12 with 100% of FiO2, this patient is having problem with the chest. One organ involved which you could find out just by looking at the two is that lung is involved. Second, after looking at the vent and patient is on control mode. Control mode patient on fentanyl, on etracurium with PEEP high or 10 with saturation of 90%, that means this patient is having either ARDS or some etiology. Okay? Now, infusion pump, other than these two, what we are seeing is human ectopic. Means sugars must be an issue. This patient must be diabetic or recently non-diabetic. So, sugar must be an issue. Now, this much we have seen. Now, what are the drains at the bedside of the patient? Look at this, is the Euro bag which we are seeing. Okay? Urine seems to be quite okay, but it should ask the staff or how much is the urine coming. I think its urine is coming quite okay. Bag is full. Only thing is it a little bit turbid or dark colored. Maybe this patient could be dehydrated. It doesn't seem like to be patient having jaundice. It is not that typical yellowish. It's just dark. I think from my this interpretation, I know that this patient could be dehydrated, or patient could be on fluid restrictive therapy for maintenance of for the ARDS ventilation. So there could be a fluid loss. Now, any drain present there, madam? Doctor?
No.
Cheek. Now, other than looking at the vitals, you should always check the pressure in the pressure bag, or which is monitoring the arterial blood pressure. What is the pressure in the pressure bag? It should be around 200-300. If it is not there, your blood pressure readings will be false. So always check the dome, Zwering level, heart pressure. Now we have come to patient per se. Till now we have got an idea that patient is hemodynamically stable. The major issue is, looks like a chest and sugars, and patient may be a little bit dehydrated. This is the thing we are getting. Now when you examine the patient, can you give me some hand wash? Don't move this. Okay. Now when you examine the patient, always look for lines and tubes which are happening. Now I am seeing this patient, right, if I see the Ryle's tube, I think it is fixed at 60, which is quite okay. You will see the central line dressing per se at the dressing tight is okay, but is sticking is getting removed here. There doesn't seems to be any blood here in the line. It's fine. These are the infusion pumps going on. Now tracheostomy is there. If I see a tracheostomy, 90-95% of the time I know that this patient must be a difficult to wean patient, or this patient is rare in the ICU for a long time, because we don't do a tracheostomy on day one. So by this we get an idea that this is a patient is here for a longer time. Always check for the pressure pressure in the cuff. You can measure it by pressure manometer, which is available in the ICU. So if it is more, it will cause tracheal necrosis. So always check the pressure in the cuff. Now tracheostomy is there. Expose the patient properly. Expose the patient properly. I am not going to teach in this video examination of different system or all this. We can have separate class for that. What I am telling you, how to approach a patient in ICU. Now you should expose the patient. Now radial line is there in the left hand. You should always look for the, is there any ischemia in the lung, or there is swelling in the lung, whether the arterial line is blocking the flow of the blood. These things you should see. Here there is a dressing. I think arterial line must be there and which is been removed. See? Now when you after exposing the patient, do a general examination, fast examination. You can look at the eyes, whether they are how whether they are pale or congested, then central line, airway, and hands, is there an edema, anasarca on the limbs, is there any swelling particular, is the patient developing DVT, or there is a fluid overload, or the peripheries are very cold. Just go a general examination. We can expose. Then the approach is, after doing a general examination, you should examine the system which is involved the most. From whatever information we have gathered, we know that it is the chest which is involved. So now you will expose the patient, inspect, percuss. At times it is not difficult, but areas which you can percuss, and then you can palpate. And palpation in ARDS is important, because at times if there is a pneumothorax developing, early pneumothorax, there can be crepitus here and there, high chances of barotrauma, then you can auscultate. After doing the main system which is involved, then you can do a examination of different system, like abdomen, neurology you can't assess, but at least you because he's on sedation, but at least you should assess whether the sedation is proper or not proper. When I'm examining whether he's opening eyes or whether he's moving the limbs, if the sedation is not adequate, you need to increase the doses. Then after you have done this, you should always try to look at the back. If patient is not suppose in a condition to get, you can turn the back, you bring, call the staff during the sponging, how was the back, is there any bed sore, any if you still want, you can do that. Okay. Now after doing all this, you should ask the staff or the resident or the doctor here after examination, is in last 24 hours, is there something major happened? Like, sir, we need to see whether there was a dramatic change, shift in the oxygen level or PEEP level, whether there any fluctuations in the blood pressure. This you can do while examining the patient bedside. If there are the infusions going on, you can ask whether the insulin requirement has gone up, or there was a support beforehand, the blood pressure is itself, or the support has been recently tapered off, or the FiO2 has been recently increased, or the PEEP. This you can see, ask the trend while you are examining the patient bedside only. After that, when you've examined, you need to clarify the issue. You need to jot down the issue. So this patient, my patient, he or she is in ICU because this patient is having ARDS most probably. Maybe looks like obese and diabetic, so this could be one of the reason. And I am worried about his hydration status. Now you will see the labs charts. In this patient, if we see the labs, urine is adequate, but his sodium is 166. That means there is a fluid loss, you need to correct that. You need to see the sugars. Is the patient running any fever, new onset fever or not? Is there any issue which the resident wants to tell you? This patient is a patient of stroke. So which you cannot figure out right from now because he is sedated, but the history will tell us. Which you can pick in the previous one. He present with hemiplegia, sudden onset, intubated, and then develop pneumonia. Now when you have looked at the charts and the labs in last 24 hours and the current one, you can jot down your plan for the next 24 hours. What I am going to plan or change what I my plan I am going to plan for next 24 hours. What is my goal? So whether we need to change the ventilator setting, whether we need to change the adjustment in this insulin, we need to shift on the lanters or something else. So once you have decided the 24 hour plan, then you get an idea, this our patient needs to come out of the ARDS primary, then only he or she will be shifted to ward. Secondly, the stroke, how much was the stroke, you can look at the scans, the history will tell you. So this way you should approach any patient. Idea is, whenever you see a patient, the single point message if you want to take from this lecture is, you should always stand in front of the patient and ask why this patient is in ICU. If you by hook and crook you can figure out what is wrong with the patient, you will know and you will deduct the plan how I can move him out of the ICU. So that's the thing. Any questions in this? I think we can stop here. Okay, thank you.